Welcome, welcome. Thanks for being here today. As part of our digital worship service, we welcome you. Wherever you are viewing this from, it's good to have you with us today. We have been outside for the past four or five Sundays. We did a filmed version of the outdoor worship last week, and previous to that, we were outside for, I think, four Sundays in person. And of course, the weather has changed, as many of you are aware, and it got very, very cold this week. So we are, and the report said scattered showers for today. So we're not outside. And at this point, we may be shifting back. It may be that we can't do outdoor worship from this point. We are going to keep coming to you with virtual worship services. Today is also our Commitment Sunday. It is the time where we as a church family commit to the life and the ministry and the work of the church for this coming year. One of the things we're going to talk about today is how all of us as part of a faith community, part of this congregation, that we are called to be people of hope for this community, for the larger world, and be people of hope in the way that we live and the way that we hold out God's love to others. So it's great to have you here. We're glad to have you worshiping with us. We like to say whoever you are and wherever you are in your journey of faith, you are welcome here. It's good to have you here. Let us join together now in the worship of God. Hi, kids. It's Pastor Joe here. Good to see you today. I brought some pieces of wood with me today. Some of you have seen pieces of wood like this, maybe out in your garage or in your backyard. You know, we know that wood, piece of wood like this, comes from a tree, right? And if you look at the sides of a piece of wood, I don't know if you can see that there, but you can see it has lines along it. And that's called the grain. It's called the grain of the wood. But what it really is that's the rings, the growth rings on the tree. Some of you have seen that in school or out in the woods where someone cuts along the inside of it, along the crossways across a tree, and you can see the rings that go out. If you look on this piece of wood this way, you can see that the center of the tree was here and the rings go out, you know, out like this. And so that's how much the tree grew every single year. And you can see that in the rings. Sometimes the rings are close together. And that means the tree didn't grow quite as much that year. Maybe you didn't have as much water, didn't have as much food. And then other years, there's a big space between the two rings, and that means the tree grew a lot. See it on this little piece of wood too. On this one, the center would have been here, and you can see the rings going out like this. So most pieces of wood, you can see something like that, and you know that the tree continues to grow. Well, you know, we continue to grow as well, all of us. And all of you continue to grow. You grow bigger and stronger, right? And you're getting taller. So you're growing in a physical way, but you're also growing with your mind. You're also growing in terms of what you know and what you learn at school, and you're getting smarter and smarter. And so we grow in physical body, and we grow in intelligence, and we can also grow closer to God. Do you all know some ways that we would grow, like we could grow and become closer to God? If you were sitting here in the church right now, we would talk about coming to Sunday school. We would talk about praying to God each day. And I know a lot of you do pray to God each day. That helps us grow closer to God. And then we learn the stories about Jesus. And then we even try to practice some of the things that Jesus taught us about, like sharing things and forgiving other people. So when we pray and when we learn the stories about Jesus and when we practice what Jesus taught us, little by little, it's just like these rings, little by little, we grow each year and we keep growing closer to God. So I want you to remember that yes, we grow physically, and yes, we grow in how smart we are, but we also can grow closer to God. Can you remember that? Okay, let's have a prayer, and we'll go from there. Okay, let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you so much that everything grows, everything alive in this world grows, and just like trees, we keep growing as well. We grow physically, we grow with our minds and our brains, but we also grow closer to you. Help us always to remember to keep growing in every way. Watch over us and be with us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for joining us today, kids. Listen to your parents, okay? Listen to your parents. And have fun. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, not the present nor the future, nor any other power, height nor depth, not anything in all creation, not anything in all creation
Our scripture reading today comes from Psalm 40, verses 1 through 5. Psalm 40, 1 through 5. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after false gods. You have multiplied, O Lord, my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us. None can compare with you. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be counted. May God grant to our understanding the reading of this holy word. In a very small article in the back pages of the obituary section, the notice read, "Truck rollover kills two, injures two. Truck rollover kills two, injures two." A Ridgecrest man and woman have died after they were thrown from the bed of a pickup truck in a crash police believe was alcohol related. The driver of the truck was being held at the local hospital pending arrest on charges of felony drunk driving. The article went on to give a few other little details, but that was most of it right there. You know, when I see articles like this one, usually they're three or four pages back, a little tiny article here or there, but I often stop and wonder about the people involved. Who are they? What are their lives like? what kind of devastation occurs and how many lives are destroyed in something like this. Do the families of those who have died have friends around? People to uphold them and care for them in their despair? Our passage today is one of the great Psalms. The Psalms are such kind of heartfelt expressions of our deepest longings and our feelings and our emotions. Today's psalm is a psalm of praise and thanksgiving from one who has placed his trust in God and was delivered. What beautiful and powerful words. I waited patiently for the Lord. He heard my cry. He drew me up out of the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. Put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Boy, don't you just get a vivid picture of that? To know that the psalm writer really understands what life can be like sometimes. The desolate pit, the slimy swamp, the miry bog, the mud hole. I think we're talking about the same thing. Use different phrases, but we're talking about the same thing. You know, there's a great song by the group U2. U2 did a great musical version of this psalm. And some of you know it from 30 years ago. And that song is just, they just call it 40. They just call it, the title of the song is 40, but it's these exact words set to that classic U2 kind of a sound with the sort of the driving guitar and all of that. But it's a great song that puts this psalm to music. The news article read, truck rollover kills two, injures two. Years ago, I discovered that Brad Lewis was the man who was killed when he was thrown from the bed of that truck. Brad was a lineman working for an electrical utility company. He was in his late 20s, and he had experienced some pretty tumultuous ups and downs in his young life. He had become addicted to alcohol, but through God's grace and the support of his friends, Brad was beginning to take a look at his life. He was sort of figuring out where he was. He was beginning to see the larger picture. There was a poem that Brad carried around with him. It's a poem that became especially meaningful to him, and I believe it has become meaningful to a lot of people who have gone through 12-step programs. Brad felt that it described him very well. The poem was called An Autobiography in 5 Short Chapters by Portia Nelson. I'm going to share the whole autobiography with you. Chapter 1, I walk down the street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It takes forever to find a way out. Chapter 2, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place. But it isn't my fault. It still takes a long time to get out. Chapter 3, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it there. I fall in. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Chapter 5, I walk down a different street. You know, Brad's experience in life is a lot like what the rest of us experience. Deep inside, we desire to love and to care and to share with other people, and yet often we fall into, call it what you will, the slimy hole, the desolate pit, the miry bog we fall in. And for some of us, it's a pit of despair. Some of us, it's the cavern of loneliness. For some of it is the pit. The pit is addiction or anger. Sometimes the pit is even the pit of worldly success. There was a man who lived in Turlock and who was part of the church that I served when we lived there. His name was Steve Fever. That's his real name, Steve Fever. And Steve was a man who had an incredibly strong faith. Steve was the water polo coach at the local high school, and he had been there for something like 37 years when he retired. A few years later, he was diagnosed with cancer, and he died about a year after that. Because Steve was such a positive and inspirational leader, he used his strength as a leader and as a coach to influence the lives of hundreds, maybe even thousands of young people who had come through his program over those many, many years. Steve could be a demanding coach, but he was demanding because he cared about the kids that he was teaching. No complaining, no whining. Make choices on the hand that you're dealt. Winning requires hard work, he would say. If winning was easy, everyone would do it. His teams and his classes were not just about playing the game. They were essentially life lessons, because Steve always believed that the lesson you learned for life was more important than each and every game that you were playing. Coach Fever would fill his workouts with words of advice and wisdom. Later, some of his students even called them Feverisms because of his name, right? Feverisms. Let's turn stumbling blocks into stepping stones. Ethics comes first. Confidence comes from being prepared. Preparedness comes through practice. I could go on and on with Steve Fever's many sayings that he picked up over the years. Just a couple of days before he died, I visited with Steve. There was a depth of clarity for him and insightfulness there in that final week that I know was a real blessing to his family. I was moved by what Steve said just a couple of days before he passed. And so after that visit, I went and I wrote it down. And he said, "So often in life we live day to day not thinking very much about God. We forget about God." And he even quoted that passage in the Bible that says, "Hearers are like those who look at themselves in the mirror and then immediately walk away and forget what they are like." But then Steve continued, "From the place where I am right now," he said, "there's a real understanding that God is much larger and more present than most of us can ever fathom." There was a peace and there was a strength in Steve's eyes as he looked at each one of us and as he told each member of his family that he loved them. And as I thought about Steve's impact, I realized that this inspirational teacher was still teaching even in those final hours. Our passage says, "He pulled me up out of the miry bog and set my feet upon a rock." Our message today, our news of great joy, is that we worship a God who has the power to draw us up out of the pit and pull us forth and to place our feet upon solid rock. God had worked through Steve to pull countless young people out of the pit and set their feet upon a solid foundation. And even though it's easy, I think, for us to hear the passage and look at ourselves as being the one who's down there in the miry bog, today I want to challenge you, rather than seeing ourselves as the one in the pit, ask yourself if you might also be the one reaching down. Reaching down. Might it be possible that you could be the one reaching down, giving a hand? Could God use you to help pull someone else up? I think so. I think that's possible for each of us. I've seen it many, many times. I think it's what our faith is all about. And like Steve Fever, I believe God uses us to do just that. A few years ago, I told you about a Catholic priest, Father William Lynch. What was incredible about Father Lynch is that for a time in his life, he suffered from a deep clinical depression and even mental illness. And through medical treatment and through the love and support of those around him, his loved ones who surrounded him, he was essentially pulled up out of the miry bog and was able to reemerge as someone. He wrote a book. His book was called Images of Hope. It was 30, 40 years ago now. He wrote that book and was able to reemerge as someone who had firsthand knowledge of mental illness and chronic depression, and he was able to then write about it and write what it was like and write what it was like to go through that. One of Father Lynch's definitions has remained with me over the years. His definition of hope. I've shared it with you once before. He says, hope is a sense of the possible. Hope is a sense of the possible. Hope says that the boundaries of the possible are wider than they seem. The boundaries of the possible are wider than they seem. Our passage today says, he put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to God. He says, I will sing a new song. The psalm writer is saying his perspective, his outlook have completely changed. He celebrates what God has done for him. The psalm writer is saying, I have hope. I have possibility. I have a sense that the boundaries of the possible are wider than they have seemed. One of the things I realize is that as a faith community, you know, on this commitment day, as we look toward, we're coming out of maybe one of the most difficult years we've faced, but we're looking toward next year and what will be a part of next year. But I can't help but feel that we are called to be a people of hope. We are meant to be people who sing a new song. We are meant to be people who live out of a sense of the possible. Indeed, people like Steve Fever, who believe that the boundaries of the possible are wider than they seem. I think that's what's happening when folks in this church started making phone calls to others in the church when we locked down due to the pandemic. Lynn Wannacott and other church leaders came forward and said, we need to check on everybody. And many of you have received phone calls from those callers in our church. They may not use these exact words, but they're saying, we are with you. God's love is present here. God's hope is present here. I think that's what's happening when our youth individually at home folded over 500 origami paper cranes and sent them to firefighters and first responders. They are saying, this is possible. God's love is present here. God's hope is present here. I think that's what's happening when bags of food were taken to several of our families back in May because supplies of some food staples seemed to be running low for some folks. The church was saying, this is possible. God's love is present here. God's hope is present here. I think that's what happens in countless ways each and every week in our church family when people share words of scripture with each other in our small group settings or in our Zoom meetings, when a helping hand is offered, when a listening ear is given, when one person cares for another, we are saying, this is possible. God's love is present here. God's hope is present here. Even in this year of the pandemic, we seek to be molded and shaped and used by God for God's own purposes, to move out into this world as people of hope, to move out into this world as people who believe that the boundaries of the possible are wider than they seem. You see, I never knew Brad Lewis. I never met him. The fellow I mentioned at the beginning today, the guy who was the electrical lineman. But I learned about Brad Lewis from four kind of scraggly, scruffy friends who wandered into the Bakersfield church more than 25 years ago. They wanted to do a memorial service for their buddy. They were the ones who had pulled Brad up out of the pit. They were the ones God had used to pull him up and out and put his feet upon that solid rock. And by the way, there's one more verse that didn't appear in Brad's poem. And I think it's the verse that most applies to us as Christians and most applies to us as people of this church family. And it goes like this. A guy is walking down the street. He falls into a hole. He can't get out. His friend comes along and jumps into the hole with him. The guy turns to his friend and says, "Why did you do that? Now we're both stuck down here." And the friend turns to him and says, "No, you don't realize. I've been down here before, and I know the way out." Would you pray with me right now? Let's pray together. Loving God, these words of Scripture are meant to be a guide to us. They suggest that we are to be people who live out of a sense of the possible, indeed a people who believe that the boundaries of the possible are wider than they seem. Lord, help us to come to your table today with a new sense of hope. As we come forward on this Commitment Sunday, help us to go forth into our lives with the knowledge that you are indeed present with us, that you can help us to open the eyes of our hearts. And Lord, we may indeed be the one down in the pit, but we are also, so many times, we are the one that you can use to pull another person up and out. Be with us now and help us to see the incredible possibilities that lie before us, both as individuals and as your church. In the name of the one who showed us the way, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Here up in the front of the church, and as we each year come forward to receive communion, right as soon as you've received communion, we often place our commitment cards in these baskets. Well, we can't do that this year, obviously, but we can't do it in person anyway. But we can, do it in a virtual, manner. Most of you should have received a letter this past week from Charlotte Bailey asking you to prayerfully consider your commitment to our church for this coming year. That letter had a commitment card in it, and I hope you will use that commitment card to prayerfully make a commitment to our church for this coming year. You know, as we share the Lord's Supper today, I would ask that as you receive the elements, that you also take a moment to lift up a prayer of gratitude to God and silently your prayer of commitment to this church family. And I hope that after our worship service today, that you would place the card in the envelope that is provided and go ahead and send it back here to the church. By the way, I always like to say, if you're viewing our service, maybe you came online and you found our church virtually, you've never actually been here, but you're viewing us and you're viewing us for the first time, or you've just been with us for a few times, we want you to know that your presence as part of our worshiping community is very important to us and a real gift to us. These commitment cards we're talking about are for those who have chosen to make this their church home. We hope that you will include this church family in your thoughts and your prayers. Well, we move now into our time of sharing the Lord's Supper together. And as we do so, we are reminded that each week that we are connected to one another across time and distance and space, and that even though that this service is being brought to you virtually, that we are connected to one another. We are much like that group of disciples that sat at table with Jesus on the night that he was betrayed. On that night, as Jesus took the bread of the Passover meal, a meal with friends, a meal that was very familiar to all of them, he took the elements of that meal and he gave them a brand new meaning. After giving God thanks and praise, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Whenever you do this, remember me." And then again after supper, Jesus took the cup. And after giving God thanks and praise, he gave it to his disciples saying, "Drink this, each of you. This is my blood of the new covenant shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink of this, remember me." And so today, as we gather from backyards and living rooms and kitchens, from wherever you are located, we do remember. We remember in a way that brings the very presence of the risen Christ back into our midst. Truly, he is present here among us, among all the different settings that we find ourselves in. And just as we come together as a church family around this one cup, we are reminded that we are connected to one another, that we are one family in Christ, connected to Christ, connected to one another. And just as we share this bread that has been broken, we are reminded that each one of us comes before God broken in some way, in need of God's love, in need of God's forgiveness, and in need of God's healing touch. And so we come to the table in that spirit. I've been inviting you all along during our time of pandemic. I've been inviting you to find the elements that you may have in your own home. It may not be bread and grape juice. It may be crackers and fruit punch. But whatever those elements are, we ask that you bring them to the table, to your table, and that we join together now in the sharing of this sacrament, the outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual reality, that this becomes a sacramental time for us. And so I invite you to join with us now, with each one of us, as we share together, my friends, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Receive now these holy gifts in great thanksgiving. Let's pray together right now. Loving God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for the ability to gather virtually. We thank you that you continue to remind us of our connection to you and to one another. Help us on this commitment day to recommit ourselves to being people of hope, people who take your message of love and caring out into this wider community in our world, the world around us. Even in this time of pandemic and financial hardship and so many tensions in our larger society, Lord, we pray that you will be present to us, that you will guide us, that you will walk with us. And so be with us now and through this coming week. Watch over us and guide us in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. Before we move into our time of prayer today, I want to remind you again, as you view the service virtually, that we are so grateful for the many gifts and offerings that all of you have continued to send to the church and has really supported our ministries all these many months. If you wish to make an offering, you can go to the very page that brought you to this worship service, our church worship, our website worship page, and you'll find a link there, a little button that you can click that will take you to a secure site so that you can make an electronic donation. If you wish to send donations, pledges, and gifts, you can send them directly here to the church, to our address on East Street, or also to our P.O. box. But we remain grateful for all the ways that you continue to support our church family. Well, as we move into our time of prayer, I do want to lift up some folks that we are continuing to hold in our prayers, members of our church family. Ray Bissell, I mentioned last week outdoors that he had taken a fall and is recovering. We lift up Pat Flower and Don Fields, both dealing with health issues. Loris and Sherry Dobbins, also dealing with health issues. Shirley Davis, she continues treatment for cancer. And also we continue to lift up Maxine Adams' husband, Fred. And there are others as well that we are holding in prayer right now. And if you look at that, if you look at our church newsletter, the advance that came last week, you're going to also see some other names and family members and friends of church members that we are holding in prayer at this time as well. Well, let's join our hearts together as we come together in a time of prayer. Would you pray with me? Loving God, eternal presence, we thank you for the opportunity to gather this day to worship. As we come to this moment and to this time, hear the cries and the concerns of our hearts, the fears, the joys, the hopes that we bring with us this morning. Lord, today we do look at hope, the hope that lives can be transformed, that hearts can be changed, that your love can be made visible in our world. You call us to make your teachings real. We pray that the hope that we have seen in part will be known completely in people's lives. We hold in our hearts today these folks that I have mentioned aloud. And we also lift up the prayers, the silent prayers that are put forth by each person who is viewing this service or joining us in this service today. Lord, we know that you hear the prayers that are held upon the hearts of each person who is part of our worshiping family. We know that you hear those prayers and that you receive those prayers, that you take them unto yourself. Lord, we are often quick to point out what is not possible. Many times we are slow to trust. We are slow to open ourselves to you. But hope is the understanding that what is possible is bigger and wider than we originally thought. On this commitment day, help us to realize that our commitment is a response to the love that you have shown to us, an extension, really, of our entire lives. As we have said in our membership vows, prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, all of these are ways, Lord, that we praise you and support you. Lord, we come to you in that spirit as we pray together, individually, wherever we are located. We pray now the prayer which your beloved Son taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we thank you once again for joining us in our digital service. Receive now our sending forth and our benediction. My friends, go now in peace. love God, and serve the people. And may our God, the God who works through each and every one of us to pull us up out of the miry bog, to allow us to help pull someone up out of the desolate pit, may that God give us the strength and the courage to be his hands and his heart in this world. Go now in his peace, go in his presence, and go in God's grace. Amen.